This is Mariama Ba. She was born in a social milieu strongly shaped by traditions, centenary values, and religious practices. Since her childhood, she learned to respect such norms, recognizing their importance as parameters for a civilized and respectful life. At the same time, she went beyond these norms, identifying areas in which social life must be rethought and modernized. In this way, her life represented a quest for the right balance, the perfect combination between tradition and modernity. Moreover, such quest was not undertaken from an abstract point of view, but from the point of view of a woman who was at the same time a mother, an activist, and a thinker. In order to spread her ideas and disseminate her provocations, she used powerful resources, words carefully selected, paragraphs elegantly constructed, pages covered with imaginative stories. Mariama Ba was a writer.
One day now, one day now, one day.
Mariama was born on the 17th of April 1929 in the city of Dakar, Senegal, as the daughter of a wealthy family. She was born into the Lebu community, an ethnic group deeply connected with the Muslim faith. Her father was a well-educated man working as a civil servant. When Mariama was in her first years of life, her mother passed away. She was then raised by her grandparents, growing up in a traditional Muslim environment punctuated by religious rituals. In that context, girls did not usually attend the school, but Mariama's father, being an intellectual man, wanted his daughter to receive school education. Mariama attended both the Quranic and the French school for girls. Rapidly, she proved an outstanding student, displaying a particularly remarkable performance in French. Her teachers and colleagues perceived an uncommon ability for writing stories, showing a creativity and deepness of thought which were rare for students of her age.
Abdu Huyambar nyare malaikala khawe he chiko dano sesaro momo monila degam julinga momo monila degam wonga
When Mariama completed her basic studies, her grandparents wanted her to stop attending the school. For them, being able to read, write, and perform fundamental calculations was more than sufficient for a young lady. In their traditional approach, Mariama should devote herself to religious life and learn the skills needed for becoming a good wife in the future. Mariama's father had a different opinion, though. In 1943, in spite of the opposition from the grandparents, Mariama joined the Rufisque Normal School. In addition to encouraging the girl's education, her father bought several books to her. To make sure that Mariama was actually reading all those books, he asked her to give oral summaries of stories, concepts, and teachings. With such knowledge, the girl's writing abilities was further honed. Her teachers were impressed with the texts she wrote as home lessons. On a certain occasion, her teacher showed one of these texts to the director of a local magazine. The man was so astonished with the quality of the text that he made it be published in the magazine. In this way, Mariama's talent for writing began to be recognized more largely. Many saw in her a rising star of literature.
Yangi dagarlu wante manogo ul so bayin ni jeliko Yangi dirok bale bunyu dagawal anak yow lekoto Yangi bagade ndak yow nanato ul so bayin ni jeliko ndak mo lay may do dibi dibi re
In 1947, Mariama completed her studies and obtained a teaching certificate. She became a school teacher, an activity which she performed for 12 years and which she only abandoned for health reasons. In 1957, her father assumed the direction of the Ministry of Health of Senegal. Mariama got married and had three child girls. But the relation deteriorated and ended up in a divorce. In the Muslim tradition, the vows made in marriage are different from those made in the Christian tradition. As a consequence, the divorce is a less cumbersome and traumatic process, unless the woman continues to rely on the man for financial matters. This was not Mariama's case. She had a second marriage, which did not last long. Finally, she had a third marriage with Obaid Diop, a politician member of the National Congress. In total, Mariama had 9 children, 7 girls and 2 boys. Her marriage experiences made her become very concerned about the fragile situation of women in the traditional Senegalese context. If her intellectual and financial independence made it possible to deal with marriage and divorce with serenity, for many women those experiences represented a source of weakness, submission, and despair. Mariama became member of the Federation of Women's Associations of Senegal. She also joined the International Soroptimist, a feminist foundation. She gave public talks and wrote articles for newspapers, advocating for women's rights, including the right for education. She denounced the hardships faced by married women in the highly traditional African societies. In these activities, Mariama continued to display her skills in using words. Friends strongly encouraged her to explore this talent for the development of a more ambitious literary project. Finally, Mariama was convinced that she should write a novel.
Bye boy, bangay bagay ay boy. Bagger rek mo taxon bye. Bye boy. Yay boy, bangay nangul bye boy. Say rek mo la taxon jok. Nanga mo ñoy yay. Manerera amul bay xamako bu ngeen waxtane jubo manerero amul yay ñaka waxtana xam ngeen rero amul bay ñaka waxtana. Bye boy. Yay boy.
Hamadoulaye, a woman in her 50s, decides to write a letter to her friend Essatou. In the letter, Hamadoulaye speaks her heart out, detailing all the frustrations and hardships she has faced over the last years. She is a well-educated woman who spent years working as a teacher. Her husband has just died from a heart attack. But the event is not the reason of Hamadoulaye's distress. In fact, her deceased husband was the cause of her sufferings. Her letter describes how her husband changed his behavior, becoming increasingly cold and negligent. Eventually, she discovered that the man had secretly taken a second wife. This new wife was actually his daughter's school best friend. That is, the man has now a wife that is so young that she could be Hamadoulaye's daughter. Her sentiments are too deep and tumultuous for just one letter. In this way, she writes a second letter and then a series of letters in which her feelings are spelled out. She describes how she felt increasingly neglected by the man, which had become enchanted by the lady's charms of young woman. According to the tradition, he continued to have duties towards the first family, but he ignored even such traditional mandates. Abandoned after 30 years of marriage and having to take care of many children, Hamadoulaye has to find force to cope with loneliness, parental commitments, and the approaching old age. Ideally, her situation would be solved with some expressions of friendship and compassion, but there seemed to be no solution for her troubles in the rigid traditional and religious milieu. Therefore, in order to do justice to what she feels, she has to compose such a long letter.
bujarwe talgama na bujarwe talganyo sayumaye wadu kasane sayumaye wadu kasane Nabujarwe dalgale Subangol nyom nyongi kha Waktu andanyu layla Waktu rer danyu layla
In 1980, Mariama Ba received an unexpected visit from a friend. In excitement, the woman said that Mariama was being invited to travel to Germany, where she would be awarded a literature prize. Indeed, So Long a Letter, the novel that she had published in the previous year, gained quick recognition among critics and literature fans. In the 1980 Frankfurt Book Fair, Mariama was greeted by the audience and voiced her acceptance speech. She declared to be surprised that the decision had been taken to award the prize to a book written in French by an African woman. She said that in a sense, her novel echoes the centenary cry coming from women's hearts. She declared, "If this book is translated, there will be many countries that will be able to hear our cry, our own cry. The cry that they utter, the women from these other countries, their cry will not be exactly the same as ours. We have not all got the same problems. But there is a fundamental unity in all of our sufferings and in our desire for liberation and in our desire to cut off the chains which date from antiquity." Indeed, the novel has received translations in several languages. Its success has reverberated in many countries and has been consolidated across the decades. Today, the book continues to be the most famous novel written by a female African writer. Happy and surprised with such quick success, Mariama decided to write a new novel.
Toutes les femmes sont des reines, certaines plus reines que les reines. Elles disent des choses qui surprennent, elles brisent les hommes qu'elles enchaînent. Cette chanson pour cette reine qui dit à son roi, maintenant, je m'en vais avec le vent. Avec les barbares d'Occident. Ce que tu n'as pas défendu par les armes, ne crois pas le garder avec tes larmes. Je m'en vais où ton peuple va. Je m'en vais me chercher un endroit, je m'en vais. Je m'en vais.
Ousmane was a poor Senegalese man deeply attached to his mother, a Muslim devotee. As a strategy to lift himself and the mother out of poverty, he studied hard for many years. He managed to get to the university, where he met Mireille, a French girl, daughter of a rich French diplomat. they began a relationship. When Mireille's father found out that his daughter was in a relationship with a local poor black student, he got so furious that he decided to send the girl back to France. Living in two different countries, the couple continued to be in touch by secretly exchanging love letters. After some years, already as a university graduate, Ousmane traveled to France to meet Mireille. The couple got married and traveled back to Senegal. Doing so, Mireille abandoned her family, leaving her old life behind. In spite of Ousmane's successful career as a respected scholar, and in spite of the couple's happy life, Mireille had to struggle with the traditional milieu she found herself in. Things were particularly difficult in her relationship with Ousmane's mother. The old woman could not accept Mireille's behavior of modern and independent woman. In her mind, a wife should be subservient, devoting herself entirely to the household and the husband. While these tensions were going on, Ousmane met an old friend, an attractive local woman. He engages in a parallel relation outside the family. Mireille, who was then pregnant, observed Ousmane become a distant and forgetful husband. Eventually, she discovered that her husband was in a relation with another woman. Her mental distress was so high that violent and tragic scenes unfolded as a consequence of that discovery. Furious and frustrated, Mireille becomes the incarnation of the clash that may result when diverse cultural backgrounds and life aspirations are mingled.
Ki man yomba na lol waye bu man xalam mo jafé Say wajur lu bax lañ la digal buñu sañon ken du la gën kon lu bax lañ la yene kon bok ëlëk bu reccu na sama yaay boy sorina kuma kay joye
When Mariam Aba finished to write A Scarlet Song, her second novel, she was already in a quite advanced state of a cancer. On the 17th of August 1981, her life was taken away by the disease. The novel was published after her death. Once again, Mariama's literary talent was acclaimed by both critics and the public. Her life and her so short literary work became a symbol of women's desire and fight for liberation from the fetters of tradition. Even though some interpreters say that she criticized the Muslim faith, she was a follower of the Muslim religion during her entire life. In a sense, it can be said that she tried to combine tradition and modernity, compliance and independence in a harmonious way. A pioneer of female African writers, she has been an inspiration for other women who devote themselves to literature, intellectual life, and creative work. A girls' school in the Goree Island was named after Mariama. In this way, she continues to be a model for African women since their childhood. The feminine cause was the flag that Mariama tirelessly agitated. And the essence of this cause is not complex. In an interview given in 1979, Mariama put it in a simple and direct way. Women just wish to be loved. Women give back the love they receive.
Yamom ya mom sa Allah di bay ngour ñow duggal ci loxom ak bor fekk la ca gantax ba meñ lo negati yo kon jara ma bay kat ku fi xib ya ko dundal ba musu ni waaw ku fi febar ya ko nandal akireen ba mu fi kon jara ma bay kat ku fi xib ya ko dundal ba musu ni waaw ku fi febar ya ko nandal akireen ba mu fi
This is the Aziza. Her story was originally told and spread by the Dahomey tribes of West Africa. The Aziza is a small humanoid, which generally takes the form of a woman. In addition, she's got wings that resemble those of an insect or a butterfly. She's a beautiful creature that's usually immersed in a magical light, glowing in a special way. She's a kind and benevolent creature who lives in the forest, generally close to an anthill or in the branches of a silk cotton tree. She is described as a diligent protector of plants, animals, and trees. With her generous heart, the Aziza likes helping human beings. For example, she assists hunters looking for food in the forest. Thanks to her, hunters have learned to use several hunting techniques. It's also said that humans first learned to master and use fire with the Aziza. The more difficult the situation that people find themselves in, the greater the care dedicated by the Aziza in order to help. When summoned by people, the Aziza follows her nature and does not spare energies to be of some help. However, there was a time when people, realizing how helpful the Aziza could be, began to abuse her kindness and ask for help too frequently, for even the most mundane problems. This is when the Aziza decided to live in the forest and began to shun people's company. Some say, however, that the Aziza lives in the forest and is rarely seen just because she is too shy. She is a very energetic being. The light that surrounds her derives from the energy crossing over her body. When necessary, she is able to focus and channel such energy in order to change the course of actions and events. Moreover, she can use this power to project images and thoughts into people's minds. In this way, the Aziza becomes a source of insights, feelings, and knowledge. In addition to being a powerful source of good energy, the Aziza is deeply attracted by humans with good energy. When she comes close to people who are generous, kind, or wise, she cannot help flying to where that person is in order to promote a combination of good vibrations.
Onyambie mieule nafika na lupete na ito'y andowa. Mama, ananiyami, azizawa ka ulmi. Ay ko din na Goya mama,
oh, Aziza
Nabakia,
oh, Aziza
Masikinyo,
oh,
Goya mama, Aziza wa mama Unaniacha,
oh, Aziza
Unaniacha,
oh, Aziza
Na ananiye. Oh, Aziza
In the beginning of 1979, Mariama Ba was sat at her typewriter. She concentrated on the text she was producing, the final pages of so long a letter. With the approaching of the warm African evening, the city was plunging into a routine silence which was only broken by the noise made by her children playing in the house. Paying much attention to such noise, like a protective mother, but at the same time ignoring all noises and images, like a serious writer, she let her fingers move freely, as if guided by an energy coming from a mysterious source. The words and sentences unfolding before her eyes expressed feelings and needs that sprung from her heart, but also from an emotional source that, in a sense, waters the heart of every woman. In that late afternoon, when Mariama could barely see the sheet of paper sliding away on the typewriter, the novel was completed. In this way, a book was born as a plea for equality, a message that every human being could find, with no need for translation, in the bottom of their hearts. In that afternoon, in the slowly darkened house, a legendary being could be seen.